Now, now that we are done with our tying, our folding, our twisting, our marbling, we are now going to change the color, and that is the dyeing aspect of the fabric. Now, before you do dyeing, you need your hand gloves to cover up your hands. So this is my disposable gloves I'm going to wear. Now, I showed you the gloves that we use for dyeing, but because they are so big on my hands, I decide to use the disposable. The fabric I'm dyeing is just 1 yard. They are not thick enough, so they are in small bits. So I wear my gloves. And then you need a plastic bowl with water. Now, the water should be enough to cover the fabric because we are doing immersion. We'll do other techniques, but for now, we are starting with the immersion. So this water can take 1 yard of fabric. This is clear water. There's nothing in the water. Now, the chemicals are here. Our dyes are here. Now, the first chemical you put into the water is caustic soda. Now, to give you a general overview of the proportions that you have to use, if you are dyeing 3 yards of fabric, you need 2 spoons of caustic soda, that is 2 tablespoons of caustic soda, 1 tablespoon of VAT dye, and then 4 tablespoons of hydrosulfite. But because I'm doing just 1 yard, you realize that sometimes I just take a little of the dye. Now, if I take too much of the caustic soda and I put it in the dye, I'll weaken the fabric because the caustic soda actually opens up the pores of the fabric. So if the caustic soda is too much, it's going to open it, stretch it out, and it's going to become weak and it will tear. So this is a plastic spoon. This is assumed to be 4 tablespoons. That is the measurement. It's assumed to be 4 tablespoons. The tablespoons you use on a dining table. So I have to take 2. So it means I'll take half. But because this caustic soda will be too much for just 1 yard, I'm going to reduce it to make it just 1 spoon. So just 1 spoon of caustic soda. I'll put it in the water. And then when you put it in the water, you see that the water is cold, but the water will become warm, because the caustic soda will make the water very warm. So you can just put your hands at the bottom of it and you see that the temperature of the water will change. All right, I'm going to put 2 of the fabric. So let me add another to it. Now, when you put the caustic soda in the water, I don't know whether you can see it from the camera, you realize that it starts boiling in tiny, tiny bits. Then it means the caustic soda is very potent. If you put it in water, as it dissolves, it will start sizzling and be giving some sound. If you check the temperature of the water, the temperature has changed. It's now a little warm. Then you put your caustic soda aside. Now, we are going to dye 2 of the fabrics in violet. This is a secondary color. It's a mixture of 2 colors, but we bought it in its raw state. We didn't mix the colors together. So I'm going to take just 1 of this. I have my face mask on, but you need a nose mask, like I told you, because you don't want to be sniffing the dye and the color. So secondly, you put your dye in. Now you can see that the thing is violet. It's violet. Some people call it purple, but purple is a lighter shade of this. Purple is a lighter shade of this. So this is violet. I want you to watch something. Now the third one, I'm going to put my hydrosulfide, sodium hydrosulfide in it. And this is what would fix the dye. Because I put 2 spoons of caustic soda in this, it means I have to put 4 spoons of hydrosulfide. And this thing full is equivalent to 4 spoons. So I drop it in. Now, when you put it in, I want the camera to check the color. Look at the color of the bath. The color of the dye changes. Though you cannot smell the hydrosulfide because of the camera, it has a bad smell. But this thing will change. And if we expose this to the atmosphere, there is a chemical change that will happen. And we call it oxidation. Oxidation is the is a chemical change that has to do with the coloration of the fabric. It will go to the original color. Now the color of the bag has changed. So after you are done with your fabric, we are going to put the twisted fabric in the bath. If the fabric is thick, you can just wet it. Just drop it in water. Take it out. Squeeze the excess out. And then drop it in the bath. I'm dropping it in the bath. Now, this thing is going to stay in the bath for 40 minutes. It's going to stay in the bath for 40 minutes. Now, the bath has to cover the whole fabric. I'm tilting it so you can see it very well. So, I'm leaving this thing for the next 40 minutes. After 40 minutes, okay, I'm going to drop another one into it. But I want you to take note of something. You see that I put the first one in it like some 2 minutes before I put the second one in. They are going to fight for the strength of the color. Because the first one went into it 2 minutes earlier, it swallowed the intensity of the color. So the second one, though it's also going to be in violet, the shade might be slightly lighter than the first one. So this is what we have. So the whole of this thing is going to stay in this bath for the next 40 minutes. You can be turning it intermittently to make sure that all other portions are dyed. So like intermittently, like after every 10 minutes, you just come and turn it. After every 10 minutes, and turning it is just turning it over, just like this. You turn it over like this. But I'm going to put this one aside so that we have space for the next one. So I just drop this one. All right, I'm going to mix 2 colors for our next dyeing. I'm going to mix a color known as golden yellow. We call it golden yellow because it's a little sharper than the bright yellow. It has a little of red in it, so it looks like ripened cocoa pod. That is how golden yellow looks like. So our first chemical that we put in is the caustic soda. So 2 spoons of caustic soda. We have to stir. I'm going to do same for this water too, because I'm doing 2 different baths. So you just mix the caustic soda to make sure it's well dissolved in the water. So now this is golden yellow. After putting in the caustic soda and it's dissolved, you take your color. That's 1 spoon. I'm going to take some brown. I also stir the brown into the caustic soda solution. I'm now going to add the sodium hydrosulfite, which is the fixative. This is, if I put a cloth in this, they will all die. But I need to fix the color. So I take 4 spoons of sodium hydrosulfite, add it to the I talk about spoon. When I took the sodium hydrosulfite, I took a whole spoonful of it. Now, this plastic spoon here, you see here, you use it in scooping banku and deer wool, etc. This spoon, this plastic spoon, is equivalent to 4 tablespoons. What we use in eating on the dining table is equivalent to 4. So when I pick one of this, full of this, it means I've taken 4 tablespoons. When I take half of this, it means I've taken 2 tablespoons. When I take a quarter of this, it means I've taken 1 tablespoon. So every measurement that I'm doing, I'm not talking about this thing as a tablespoon. This is equivalent to 4 tablespoons. I hope it's true. So I have added the sodium hydrosulfite to this one. The color has changed. This is supposed to be yellow, but when you look at it, it looks black. Now, so 4 tablespoons, I put it in the brown, and then I stir, make sure it dissolves. That serves as the fixative. This is what is going to make the color stay in the fat. If you don't add it, then you are not doing any work. So now that I have these 2 bags ready for dyeing, now I'm going to dye this triangle in 2 shades. That's why I made 2 bags. I'm going to dye one side in yellow and then the other side in brown. So first, I'll put it in the yellow. I just put a tip, just half of it, and then let the other half stick out. After 40 minutes, I'll turn it to the brown. But this one, the whole thing is going to be in golden yellow. So I just dip it in. So this is how it's going to look like. So for the next 40 minutes, I'll be turning it intermittently. So I'll just put it at the side so that we make room for other dyeing. So I just put it. The first one I put in the dye, I said you turn it intermittently. So I'm going to do the second turning. I just turn it upside down. Just turn it. And then I'm going to leave it for the next, let's say we are 10 minutes gone. So we have like 30 minutes more to wait. So I'm just taking it back to its original place. All right. Now, our next dyeing process is known as table dyeing. This time around, we are not going to take the whole fabric and dip into the dye.
we are rather going to dispense the dye onto the fabric on the table. You can decide to do it on the floor or do it on a working table. Because of space, we just do it on this working table. So, like our normal bath making, we take our caustic soda. Now you see that the water I've taken is very small. You don't need plenty water for table dyeing because we are pouring the dye onto it. We are not leaving it into the in the bath. So just a little water, enough for all three. As many as fabrics that you are going to do, you just need enough. So with this one, I take 2 spoons of my caustic soda. I put it in the water and make sure it dissolves. So I'm dissolving the caustic soda. Now, because this one, we are going to use so many colors. You think about the colors that you are going to use, and then you take the lightest of the colors first. So with this, I'm going to work in golden yellow, I'll work in red, I'll work in green, and then maybe I give it a brown or something, depending on how I want it to look like. So the first color I'm going to take is my yellow. So this is the yellow. I put it in the bag. Also stay and make sure that it dissolves. Make sure you don't inhale the fumes. It gives out a lot of fumes. Add the hydrosulfide 4. So you see that this bath is very concentrated because of the amount of water I have taken. I was using the same measurement, but that water was more than this one. This one is very concentrated. So now this is where this thing comes in handy. This is what we are going to use to dispense the color onto the fabric. It's empty. So you squeeze it and then it takes the dye. So he's squeezing it for it to take the dye. When it's full, the bulb will just bubble up. The women do it better than the men. So he's taking, so he's just pouring the dye onto the fabric. Just pouring the dye onto the fabric. So this is golden yellow. You see that, you see it as black. When it oxidizes, the color will change. So you just put some pressure on the bulb and it will dispense. Just make sure that with this, it's assumed that it's gone to the other side of the fabric too. It's going to the wrong side of the fabric. And mind you, the cloth is wet. So if we should put any other color on it, the trace of the first water is going to draw the color. So they will run into each other. That is where we get the marbling effect. if you don't have this one, you can just use your the spoon to do the dispensing. You just use it, but you do it carefully. You can use this spoon, not necessarily using this one, or you use the syringe. Now he started with the spiral. I'm going to mix the second color so that when it's done, we'll just apply the second color to it. The color mixing is done in the same way the first one was done. So he's going to, you see the one that we tied, he's going to apply the yellow onto it. You see, he's doing it on the stones. So it means only the stones would take the yellow. The stones. Now, if you watch carefully, the dye has started dripping. It has started dripping. Don't worry. When it drips, just collect it. Put it back. If you have something to clean, like a foam or something, just use the foam. So that you don't have the dye spilling on yourself. Just going to clean it up. But this is the effect. It means the dye has gone underneath. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't drip, then it means it's just settling on the surface. So all the stones are going to be yellow, 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 yellow. Now, I hope you are watching this. You said that the color is changing. It's oxidizing. It's coming into contact with the atmosphere. So there's a chemical change happening to this. It's oxidizing. By the time we are done, you see the gold. So when you mix your dye and the color changes, it means the hydrosulfite is very potent. If it doesn't change, it either means you did not put hydrosulfite in the bath or the hydrosulfite is poured. You're just trying to give it some tiny, tiny. because we don't want to waste the dye. We want to exhaust everything. If we leave the dye, we won't use it for anything. So it just makes sure that we exhaust everything. At the end of it, you still have some effect that you want. It's applying the second color. You see that with the immersion, it's going to, the second color will be done after 40 minutes. But with the table dyeing, it's done simultaneously. When you are done with the first one, you go to the second one. So if you have three colors, you go on with the third one. When you are done with the second one, you go on with the third one. So he's applying green. So that is green for you. You can add more colors. More colors. Try to wipe the excess away. The excess dye that's on the table. Otherwise, it will start dripping on the floor and we'll just color our feet. But since we don't want it to. He's sprinkling water because he wants the fabric to open up. You see, the effect of this is the same as this. When you put water in it, it drags the color into different areas. When it was dry, we could have done it dry, but he wants to add more colors so that they run into each other. Uh-huh. But the tips will still be the golden yellow. So I'm just cleaning the excess. So he's just pouring this on it. The way he's doing it, because he's using the spoon, he realized that some of the tips of the stones will come into contact with the green, so don't worry. Come on, let's get another color. Give me the bowl of water, small. We want to give it another color so that we have three colors. And somebody will ask why we have to be mixing colors, missing colors, and what we already have, why didn't we use it for the table dyeing? Now, the concentration of the immersion is different from that of the table dyeing. This one, because all the colors get into the fabric within a space of, let's say, 5 minutes. After 5 minutes, we just leave it on the table. After a while, after it's oxidized, then we spread it out. But this one stays in the bath for like 40 minutes. So the concentration of this is lesser than the table dyeing. So we still have to do a different bath for the table dyeing. But we have something we call recharge. With a recharge, we use this one, but we have to add more dye to it, more powder dye to it, to make it more stronger. So I'm going to mix the last color so that we have three shades of... I've already put my caustic soda in the water. So I'm going to add my last color, which is the heaviest of the three, and it's brown. I have golden, yellow, I have green, and I have brown. So in that order, we add the brown. When we talk about a color being heavier than the other, it doesn't mean in weight. It means in intensity. So the intensity here is either lighter or darker. If you take yellow and you take brown, you realize that one has a lot of light and one has a lot of darkness. So the brown is heavier than the yellow. So when you are talking about weight, we'll say that the brown is heavier than the yellow. And like I told you from the beginning, when you are mixing colors for different shades, you do the lighter one first. We do the lighter one first because if there is a mistake with the lighter one, the dark one will easily cover the light one. But you can't let the lighter one cover the dark one. Just like you are using black and white, you can easily use black to cover white, but you can't use black to cover white. So that is the principle of. So he's going to apply the last color. That one he's doing it sparingly, because if he does it just like the first one, it means the whole work will become brown. So he's doing it sparingly, just putting it in certain portions and not putting it in other portions. So we are done with the table dyeing. We have to leave it on the table to oxidize. That is, we just leave it on the table for air to blow over for a while. Then we take it outside to dry. Now, when your fabric is dyed, you don't dry it on the line. Otherwise, the colors will drip through. You have to spread it on the floor under shade. So it could be a tree, but just make sure that there's air blowing around that area. So let's leave this thing for like 5 minutes, then we'll open it up so that you see the effect. Now, our immersion might have been ready by now. So we are ready to take it out of the bath and go and dry those ones. So I'll bring the first immersion here. I'll bring it back to the table. This is the twist. The twisted fabric. Now, when you take it out of the bag, you don't squeeze the water out. You don't squeeze. You just leave it to drip. So you use your pair of scissors to cut. Just make sure you cut through the raffia and not through the fabric. I nearly did the obvious, cutting through the fabric. But when you look at it, you see that this portion is darker than this portion. The lighter portion is where we use the raffia to hold it. If it had been very tight, it would have been white. But because it wasn't too tight, that's why it's not white. So I'm going to untwist this fabric and then I'll take it outside to dry. So as I untwist, so I'm opening it up, I'm untwisting. The first one was twisting, so I'm untwisting. So after untwisting, this is the effect that we have in one color. So assuming they were in various colors, we want to have another color. We have to allow this thing to dry, then we twist again and dye it in another color. But this is what will come out of the first color that we have. The second one that we folded in the square and tied the ends. I'm going to open that one too up. This one too, you don't have to squeeze the dye out. Scissors. So you cut through the raffia and not through the cloth. Take the raffia off. You see the light shade because of the weight of the tie. Then you take off the raffia. You see where the plating was done. You see that you have tiny spaces in between. And then where the tie is heavy, so now we are going to open this one up to our square. Where do we begin? So this is what we have for the folding and the tying. The square fold and the tying at the end. You see that you can see the tiny rings. That is where he plaited. Where you have a broad circle is where he tied a broad. So that is the difference between the two. If you want to see tiny rings, then it means instead of tying it in one bow tie, you space the tying and then you have it in this form. So you can take this one and go and dry. The duration of the drying depends on the weather. You don't need sun to dry this. You need air to dry this. If you put it under the sun, it's going to patch. Now the patching is when the irregular rays of the sun, when they come into contact with the fabric, they try to lighten the portions that the rays get into. So you don't dry it in the sun, you dry it in an airy place. So when you're going to dry it, you just lift the whole thing and go and open it up. But because I want the camera to see, I'm going to open it up here for us to see. So this is the effect of what we did on the table. When it dries, where the colors merge, where all the three colors merge, you have another color. So by the time we are done, we might have had six colors on this. We use three, but you have more colors on it. Now, with this one, the spiral, you just split the rubber band, and then that one too, you open it up. This is the effect of the spiral. For this one, you only have to, this one I have to take outside because I'm going to open it up with a fork so that all the rubber bands will just jump out of there. But if you do this, the rubber band will just come off. Or for want of doubt, let me just cut through the rubber band one by one so that those who want to see how it's, you just open it up. So when you open it up and you take the stone out, you see how it looks like. So you are going to have so many rings and it's where the rubber band is. So we are taking this one also outside. So this one is the first rectangle that we did. The smaller rectangles that we did. The smaller rectangles that we did. It could have been done in two colors or three colors, doing one side and the other side, but we decided to just do one immersion, one thick immersion. So this is with it. The other one, the last one, which is the triangle, we have put the other side. We have put the other side in a different color. So when we take it out and we open it, you just see the effect. But when it comes out, it will come out in two colors. So this is our last one. So it will come out in, I think, golden yellow and brown. These are the sheets.